This morning, gospel reading is very long, and there's a lot happening in this gospel. It's actually a really exciting gospel to preach out of, and I promise I won't preach for long. The Gospel of John, as some of you know, is my favorite gospel, and the reason for this is because it is a mystical gospel. It is a gospel filled with symbols and signs. And we see today a conversation, a meeting between Jesus and a Samaritan woman. Firstly, it's set at a well. And so we know something significant is going to happen, because in Scripture, many important things happen around a well and around the source of water. We also know from the Scriptures and from history that the Samaritans and the Jews were sworn enemies. This was for generations they despised each other. And the Jews, in fact, the Pharisees, accused Jesus at some point of being a Samaritan and doing the works of the devil. So we see Jesus having a conversation at a well with a person that his people would never speak to. So that's the first and second significant thing happening. Thirdly, it's happening at noon. And so what we know is that generally the woman come and fetch water early in the morning or late at night, just before dusk. Nobody comes to the well at noon. So that tells us something about the identity of the woman. She is an outcast of her community. And we read a little later on in the gospel story as to the source of being this outcast amongst her people. So she comes at noon because she has no social status. The fourth thing we know, and we hear that again in the gospel, is that men do not speak to women in public. And so the fact that Jesus is having this conversation is completely scandalous. And we see his disciples are even wondering, but they don't want to ask him the question. And so this morning we see Jesus, the Lamb of God, the revelation, the incarnation of God, God's Son, meeting with a despised nation, a despised woman, an outcast who is living a life of broken relationships. And we see how Jesus deals with her in this story. Firstly, Jesus appeals to her, "Woman, I am thirsty, give me a drink," and slowly draws her into a deeper conversation. In this conversation, Jesus reveals his identity for the first time and the only time in the Gospel of John. He says, "I am he," but he uses the "I am" statement. Remember the name of God from the Old Testament, when Moses asks, if they ask me who sent me to come and deliver them from Israel, who must I say? And God says, "I am has sent you." So Jesus reveals his identity to an unknown woman who is a Samaritan, who is despised and rejected by her people. And he reveals himself as the great I am. I feel like this gospel could not have come at a better time for us here, in not only our community, in our parish, or our country, but as a human family. We are living in a time that we are going to be entering not only great uncertainty, as the Archbishop Tower said, but a time when this coronavirus is going to have deep inroads and impacts in our community. And so the question becomes, how do we respond as Christians to the pandemic that is unfolding in our global family? And Jesus is offering some very practical, real ways in which we should be engaging one another. Jesus is showing the heart of God towards humanity, that God is present with us in our suffering and our circumstance, that Jesus chooses to come as a vulnerable God to a vulnerable woman in order to reveal to her love, the great love that God has for her. This living water is the Spirit of God. It seeks to bring restoration. It is the grace of God given to us for which we are not worthy and do not deserve. Paul speaks so beautifully in his letter to the Romans. Peradventure, someone might die for a righteous person, maybe for a good person, but God died for us while we were still sinners, while we were still enemies with God. And so as we look on one another, we need to look on one another with the heart of God towards each other. That no matter what is going on in that person's life, God still seeks to give that boundless gift of grace, to bring that person and that community back into the relationship that brings abundance of life and eternal life. Now, I know that for each one of us sitting here, we all have places in our lives that are broken. We all have desert spaces in our lives. We all have portions of our lives that feel like a wilderness experience. And what Jesus is saying today is, don't be like the Israelites at Meribah and Manasseh, tempting the Lord your God, trying to say to God, prove to me, God, are you still with us? Because God is always with us. God seeks to be in our present circumstance. And as we lean into that promise of life and healing, that promise of love and how we are seen, that leaning into God's love restores us. It heals us. It makes us whole. And then, like the Samaritan woman, we are called to go out and testify to others, to be that light to others. Come and see, bringing them to Jesus. Let Jesus also work with you, so that they too may experience the transformative nature of what happens when we encounter God's deep love. Paul tells us, when we are able to have this perspective of the grace in which we stand, we even glory in our suffering. And I don't know about you, but for me, life is full of suffering. There are many ups and downs. But Paul says we embrace our suffering because suffering gives us in perseverance. And as we persevere, we grow in character. And as we grow in character, we grow in hope. And what is the hope? The hope of our calling. This wonderful salvation that is offered to us. So as we journey into our suffering, individually and together, as a community, as a nation, and as a people, a human family, God seeks to use that experience to draw closer to us and to bring us closer to one another. So in many ways, as traumatic as the coronavirus news can be on our minds, we also need to remind ourselves that it is a wonderful opportunity to grow in relationship with God and one another, trusting that God seeks to be present in our circumstance. I said that I'm not going to preach long, so I want to end with this thought. I have a beautiful bookmark of an icon of Jesus and his mother Mary. And the words to the icon say, we move to God not by walking, but by loving. We move to God not by walking, but by loving. And so may the wonderful love of God continue to draw each one of us into deeper and closer relationship with one another and with this beautiful God that seeks to bring us abundant life, those living waters. And may, as we go into this week and it unfolds, because the news is shifting very quickly and many things are happening around us, many events are being cancelled and we are are all in a state of hyper alertness. Let us remember the many ways in which God has been faithful to God's promise, not only to our generation, but to every generation before us and every generation after us. And let us be the generation that stands as a Samaritan woman to a testimony to a world that needs the message of healing, hope, and love.